Good morning, everybody. I'm Mike Duran. I am a senior fellow here at Hudson and the director of our Middle East Center. This is going to air on the 27th of September, but today I think is the 22nd, if I'm not mistaken. And I have with me a man who needs no introduction, former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, but I'll give you a really short one if that's okay.
That sounds great.
As far as I know, you were born and raised in California.
That's true also.
And you went to high school just a couple of miles from my high school, and I went to high school in Fullerton. You went from there to West Point, served in the military. Then you went to Harvard Law School, then to Kansas. Do I have it wrong?
You got it right.
You were elected.
That's exactly right.
You were elected multiple times, four times? To Congress. And then you served as director of the CIA and as Secretary of State. Welcome.
Also was the assistant manager at Baskin-Robbins. I'll leave that out. My first leadership experience.
So people our age remember how exciting the 41 flavors were when they first came out.
Absolutely.
That was thrilling.
There's no doubt about it.
Yeah. Well, that's exciting. That would have been a very exciting job back then.
It was fantastic.
But that's not what we're here to talk about. You are a man under a death threat. And I'd like to get to that. But let's start with the reason why. The ostensible reason why you're under a death threat, and that's the killing of Qasem Soleimani. Could you just walk us through how the President Trump, and you made this decision? I happen to know, I don't know how much you want to talk about it, I happen to know from my sources, friends of mine in the CIA, that you made crucial decisions early on at the CIA that laid the foundation for all of this. I don't know if you can go into any of that.
I'll let you tell what your sources are.
May I tell it? Because it's an amazing story.
Sure.
It's an amazing story because it's directly related to what we're going to be talking about today. So the gentleman that you put in place to in charge of targeting Soleimani, In the CIA, they have something which I think is called a targeting brief. I forget the name of it exactly. But basically, every opponent of the United States out there has a brief on it. And the gentleman that you put in place...
I can neither confirm nor deny that.
Yeah, the brief is supposed to say, you know, how does the guy carry his money? How does he carry his cell phone? How many girlfriends does he have? Where do they live? And so on and so forth. So you could target him, you know, for intel collection or for other things if you have to do other things. So he takes one look at the targeting brief. And he says, this is unbelievable. This is like what you would write a brief to give to the president when he's going to have a meet and greet with a friendly head of state. You know, what does he like? You know, what kind of tea does he like? What are his hobbies and things like this? He said, I want a targeting brief, right? And so then there were things I won't talk about that led to the creation of a targeting brief. But this is all, of course, happening under your direction. So anyway, can you walk us through... This is a weighty decision that you made, and can you walk us through how it was made and what kind of pushback you had and what kind of considerations you had?
Absolutely. So I have to set the context for it. We came into office. The previous administration had laid down a Middle East policy that was demonstrably failing. Demonstrably failing our friend and ally Israel, demonstrably failing the Middle East, and most importantly, demonstrably failing the United States of America. They'd entered into this JCPOA, which was at the very least a patient pathway for a nuclear weapons, not just a nuclear weapon, but a nuclear weapons program for the Iranians. They were continuing to underwrite the Palestinian Authority, the terrorists there, lots of money flowing to Hamas, to Hezbollah, to the Shia militias in Iraq, to the Houthis in Yemen. The Iranians were running the table. And so we were set to try and upend that. To try and get back the order and stability. So for America, we'd have to risk putting our young kids in that dangerous place. We could reduce the risk we'd ever have to put our young kids in a dangerous place to go do what we had done so often in the Middle East. And so we had multiple elements to the strategy. The first piece was to connect very closely with our Israeli partners, our Israeli friends. My first week at CIA, I traveled to meet the then director of Mossad, a fellow named Yossi Cohen. because the because I wanted to make sure that the relationship between the CIA and Mossad was tight. Anytime you get in these organizations, they compete, right? Who's the best? Who's the greatest? They have very complementary skill sets. I knew that. I had not met Director Cohen, but I wanted to go over and see him and make sure our teams were working together. I put a guy, a world-class guy, in charge of what became our Iran Mission Center. You can look his name up. The New York Times outed him. He was an undercover agent that the New York Times put his life at risk. I will never forgive the editorial team there for having done that. I don't think his family will either. But we built out a set of systems, a set of operations, a collection capability, and then the president made the decision, rightfully, to withdraw from the JCPOA, which we'll talk about the current administration's efforts there, but it was important because it gave us the capacity to do the one thing that you can do to make sure that Iran has trouble building out a program for its nuclear efforts, and that is you deny them money. They're the world's largest state sponsor of terror. It is not close. They have a missile program that is elaborate. Their space program continues to develop, and they are underwriting soldiers in the field that are trying to kill Israelis, Arabs, and Americans all across the world. And so that was our theory of the case, and that is all background. So we began our pressure campaign. It took almost 2 years to get it in place because we didn't withdraw from the JCPOA until I was Secretary of State, so April, May of 2018. Before we actually withdrew. President made a campaign promise to do so. My predecessor was against it, and so they hadn't gotten it done. We were able to withdraw, which let us put the pressure campaign, the sanctions, and massive enforcement of those sanctions. We took Iran's foreign exchange reserves from $96 billion to $4 over the course of what was about 20 months of full implementation. We had them in a really difficult place. They, of course, responded. Everybody makes perfect sense. What was their response? Their response was artillery rockets from the Shia militias into our embassy on a near daily basis, assassination campaigns throughout the world, including in Europe, continuing to try to go around the edges and continue to spin centrifuges, continue their research R&D for their program. They shot down two American UAVs, and they fired cruise missiles directly from Iran into Abqaiq on September 14th, 2019. That's the background, but it's all important because that was the setting in which I became very concerned that we were losing our deterrence capacity with respect to Iran. They were feeling like it's the old Southwest Airlines line. They were feeling more free to move about the cabin, and we needed to get it back. Many administrations had known General Soleimani. He had been killing Americans in Iraq for years and years and years. The number is somewhere between 400 and 600 Americans whose lives no longer are because of Qasem Soleimani. We also knew he was still this important leader. He was more than a general. He was certainly that, but he was more than a general. He had a best PR team imagine. I should hire them sometime, right? He looks like the Dos Equis guy. Everybody knows him. The Iranian people love him as much as they love the Ayatollah. And for that reason, nobody wanted to touch this murderous, terrible man because they thought it would start World War III. So we weren't original in thinking, hey, eliminating him would be useful, but nobody wanted to go anywhere close to it. So we began to lay the groundwork. You talked about a little bit of it, began to lay the groundwork so that we could, if need be, present the president an option to reduce risk to the United States of America. And so it was a long time coming. It wasn't a new idea, but in December of 19, I was very worried about deterrence, and opportunity met that need. We were aware that Qasem Soleimani was currently actively plotting to kill more Americans. We also knew he was traveling. He was traveling from Beirut to Damascus and then into Baghdad. And we had done a bunch of work. We were ready. And so I flew to Mar-a-Lago at the end of December, along with Secretary Esper and Chairman Joint Chiefs of Staff Milley, brief president. President made the...
You talked about classified information at Mar-a-Lago?
What's that?
You talked about classified information
in a skiff, yes, okay. Absolutely, in the Mar-a-Lago okay. Skiff. Okay. Duly noted and certified, yes, exactly. We left no documents there. And the president made the right decision. And then your Department of Defense did an unbelievable job of executing a mission that no other nation in the world could. And we did two things that day, and this is why it mattered. First, we eliminated a terror threat, a plot, an active, ongoing, executable mission set that Soleimani was traveling to Baghdad to meet with Mohandas to talk about how and when to execute that. And second, we restored deterrence because it was such a bold move, such an unexpected move, one that everybody said, no, you can't touch, that we didn't have risk at our embassy for an awfully long time. They did respond. They fired missiles into Iraq at the U.S. military base in Iraq. There were soldiers injured. I take full responsibility for that fact. It saddens me. We didn't have anybody killed, but there were some soldiers who had there were sound waves, shock waves that injured them. But we were able to contain it. We had done enough work, and we were able to get the messaging right that it didn't create World War III, that you didn't have people killed. And we not only restored deterrence with Iran, but importantly, Xi Jinping noticed, Chairman Kim noticed, Taliban noticed, the whole world noticed that this administration was prepared to do the things it said it would do.
And all of our allies noticed.
And our friends noticed. You don't get the Abraham Accords without the strike on Soleimani. I'm convinced of it. It demonstrated that we were actually going to be active in preserving security in the region, not just pay lip service to us and go to Vienna and sign silly documents that give them the capacity to have a nuclear weapons program. Yes, the Gulf states all noticed too.
You pretty much just answered this question, but let me put it to you anyway directly, because it's such a part of the democratic messaging against this kind of operation. Susan Rice, who was President Obama's national security advisor, among other things, she immediately wrote in the New York Times after the killing of Qasem Soleimani that this was a completely counterproductive move because it was going to lead to a cycle of violence that was only going to make the situation worse in the Middle East. So how do you answer that?
Yeah, in the moment, it's very difficult to answer because we're all conjecturing about what will happen next. Today, I can prove she was wrong. Today, it didn't lead to the very cycle that she described. Indeed, I'm convinced, and one can never predict. I'm convinced 6 months, a year, another 18 months of the pressure campaign, the Iranians have to make some really hard decisions. The Iranian people would have been forced to make some incredibly difficult decisions. And we didn't get the cycle of violence. And we didn't get multiple states proliferating nuclear weapons, right? These are the things that we were able to avoid. And importantly, we should never underestimate this. And we didn't get the Chinese dropping missiles off of Taiwan. We didn't get the Taliban overrunning Kabul. These you can talk about them in isolation and verticals. We'll have another discussion about Taiwan. But these leaders watch how America behaves, and they watch if America's prepared to actually do things that everybody knows have risk attached to them. And when you're prepared to do that, I promise you, these leaders are real human beings watching everything that takes place. And so when you have a president say one thing and his staff go out and correct it, as opposed to the staff going out and saying something, the next thing you know, there's a Hellfire missile hitting a moving vehicle at an international airport going 60 miles an hour and missing the target by less than an inch, I promise you, the world notes it.
We also did it with a drone. Mm-hmm. What I mean to say is we basically, by moving our little finger, I think we sometimes forget how powerful we can be.
No other country can pull this off. We watched the military try and invade Ukraine along four axes and fail. There's nobody that could have done what our soldiers and sailors did that night. And we had good partners and friends on the operation as well. And our intelligence community did really good work in the run-up to this, and my team did a very nice job in the aftermath. You'll remember there was one other event that in that cycle, which was that the Iranians shut down a commercial airline. They fired a missile and killed a couple hundred people on a commercial aircraft as well. So those there were really three events that night.
So you earned the undying hatred of, President Raisi, among others. This January said, if Trump and Pompeo are not tried in a fair court for criminal act of assassinating General Soleimani, Muslims will take our martyrs' revenge. The aggressor, murderer, and main culprit must be tried and judged under Islamic law of retribution, and God's ruling must be carried out against him. It's against Trump, but also against you. President Raisi is in New York or was in New York yesterday. I don't know if mm-hmm. he's still there.
I was in the city too at the same time that he was.
Both of you being
had a passport. He was here in a way he should not have been.
He shouldn't
have had a visa.
He shouldn't have had a visa. There's actually a law. There's also a law in 2014 passed that sponsors of terrorism and making terroristic threats is engaging in terrorism by law. So forget about the politics, just by law. So was there any discussion with you about this? You're both being guarded by the Secret Service, are you not?
The head of state was being guarded by the Secret Service. My security detail is from the State Department. Amazing, amazing men and women who protect me every day.
It must feel a little bit odd, though, to be in the same city with this guy who's threatened you, who's here illegally.
Yes.
Right? Certainly, it's bad political judgment anyway. But to be in the same city and to see that.
I think you could be a diplomat. Use the word odd.
There was more emotion
than that.
Let's talk about your emotions, Secretary Pompeo. Tell me. we're your support network here.
Exactly. Therapy for years. The truth is that the strike that we took was both lawful. That's important to someone who served as a soldier and who cares deeply about the rule of law and the law of warfare. He was a general actively engaged in a plot to kill Americans. So this was a layup.
And who has killed many Americans.
So this was not... There are times that it's complicated. There are times that you need a bunch of lawyers to look at and they come to split this. This was not that. This was a layup from
For the record, I never think there's a time when you need a bunch of lawyers looking at you, but that's a whole other question.
You know what? I stand corrected. You are correct about that. We need one lawyer who understands mission. But this wasn't that. This wasn't a controversial. As a legal matter, this wasn't controversial. We had other times where there were long discussions. This was an easy American legal basis and an easy basis under international law as well. And so when you hear others use language like Raisi did, it's not true. But second, as a practical matter, it was important for American security. And so for those two reasons, it's not particularly emotional for me in the sense of I am confident that we did the right thing, both as a matter of law and as a matter of my responsibility as a constitutional officer. I think the president actually, it was simply my recommendation. In the end, the president is the commander in chief, and I think he made the right decision that day as well.
Well, let me talk about my emotions then, since you don't want to talk about yours. I can't find the words for my emotions, because it's more than outrage, because I find it absurd. There's so often in the world today, there are things that are happening, and you can't believe that the government is doing what it's doing. I mean, this Iran policy is one of them. This is a zombie policy. It's dead. It's been proven wrong. They're mouthing the same. I had a discussion with a senior Middle Eastern figure recently, and I said, when you talk to the senior American officials and tell them about all the money that the JCPOA is going to give to them, what do they say to you, right? And you explain how that's going to increase the capacity for terrorism. What do they say to you? And they say exactly what they were saying back in 2015. We think that they're going to use it on butter, not guns. And that's already been disproven, right? I'll get back to it later. But anyway, the policy's dead.
Yeah.
They're threatening you personally.
Yeah, and importantly, not just me, other officials as well. There was an indictment that was unsealed where they'd come after Ambassador Bolton, a former national security advisor. There are other officials as well that some of the threats have been public. There are others that are less so. But it's not all just former government officials, right? They tried to kill a civilian in Brooklyn. There were people on the ground. This has been widely reported. They are notorious. Everybody knows the Cafe Milano story when they tried to whack an ambassador, the Saudi ambassador at the Cafe Milano. So it is not historic for the Iranians to conduct assassination campaigns, not only here in the United States, but across Europe. And so to allow the butcher of Tehran, this guy Raisi, who's responsible for the death of 10, 20, 30,000 of his own people, and who is driving an Islamic regime today that is actively engaged in threatening places where there are Americans every day. Right, you have Houthi missiles today flying into Saudi Arabia where there are American contractors working. And so it's not, we can focus on me or other, but this is a global campaign putting Americans at risk. And we tell Raisi, yeah, knock yourself out, we'll provide you security, come on down, come to New York, stand on that global stage as a terrorist and tell the world you're the one trying to create peace. That is, use the word absurd, it is nutty.
It's so nutty. I realize it's a personal issue, so it's kind of funny to talk about. But when you were an assistant manager at Baskin Robbins, right? If I had come into you and after I tasted the rocky road, you know, and I said to you, if I said to you that there's a foreign government out there that has open plots to kill former American officials, and our current president is negotiating with it to give it hundreds of billions of dollars, you'd say, no, that would never happen in the United States of America. That would never happen.
Yeah.
I'm not saying this because I'm a Republican and they're Democrats.
Yeah.
I can't believe they're doing it. I can't believe they're doing it.
It's odd, and you could go through the list of the perversity, right? At the same time, they are the lead negotiator that we're working with is Russian on the Iran deal, right? We sit with Ulanov, and that's the guy. While the Russians are out killing Ukrainians, and we're providing tons of money to help the Ukrainians make sure that happens less. The Iranians are now sending conventional weapon systems, something that we stopped. I'm convinced we had snapback in place. This is a little bit in the weeds as a legal matter, but the conventional weapons ban on Iranian arms sales was expiring. And so we executed a legal right where the United States had a unilateral authority to stop that from happening and went to the UN and did, quote, snapback, end of quote. And now they are sending relatively sophisticated drones to Ukraine to help the Russian army fight them. And our answer to that is provide them more money. It's
right. Iranian
it's
drones
really quite
are
something.
In Europe, are in Europe targeting American weapon systems, and we're going to give them more money to do more of that.
We not only that, Mike. One thing I think is worth everybody's notice, because we talk about the JCPOA a lot. I think that's zombie talk in some ways. I've been trying to push back against the JCPOA literally since I was a young backbench congressman in 2014 and 15 when Tom Cotton and I found the secret side deals. I mean, this is like 7 years of
right,
my life.
Right.
But the truth is, they're giving the Iranians money today, even with the sanctions in place, because as anyone who's lived in this world knows, sanctions without enforcement are just a bad joke, right? They're just a piece of paper. And I've seen different numbers, but suffice it to say, we had the Iranians down to less than 500,000 barrels a day of crude oil, almost none of those being exchanged for cash. Today, that number is at least double, maybe triple that, almost all of which the Iranians are receiving cash. So without any lifting of sanctions, without any congressional approval, without anybody lifting any document or signing anything, they have already eviscerated the very sanctions regime that the vast majority, this isn't political, the vast majority of members of Congress support full-throatedly, Democrat and Republican alike.
That leads me to a point. I have a theory. It's not a theory, but it's very hard to know what's going on in the negotiations. And you would believe that they died right now. But it's very clear, if you look at the administration, what they're doing. For example, what you just mentioned, not enforcing sanctions on China. So China's buying a ton of oil. Supposedly, we're negotiating with Iran, but we're handing them concessions of many tens, if not more, billions of dollars while the negotiation is going on. So it's that they're either the worst negotiators in the world, which I don't believe, they're intelligent people, or there's a different conception at work. And the conception is they believe in engagement with Iran. It's back to the targeting brief, which is a meet and greet with Qasem Soleimani.
Yeah.
By the way, the same guy who told me about the targeting brief also told me that there were letters sent to Qasem Soleimani. So there was a desire, not letters of warning, letters of, gosh, I'd really like to get together with you, you know. So that is the mentality. They hide it. They know the American public isn't going to accept it. But so here's my fear. It's sort of a theory, sort of a fear. They're going to ram this down our throats after the November election. They're going to wait till the November election because they know it's politically toxic at home. There's going to be the election, and then they're going to ram it down our throats by ANARA, the Nuclear Review Act. They have to give Congress 30 days to review it. It will sit there, and Congress won't the Congress won't vote on it. So Nancy, why do I think this? Because Nancy Pelosi was asked yesterday about this precisely, and she was asked, "Are you going to allow a vote on the Iran deal?" And she said, "We have so much that we're doing before that." And I support the president. I support the nuclear agreement with Iran. Now, maybe the Iranians won't allow us to hug and kiss them, right? There's always that possibility. But there is this other possibility that they really want the deal so badly, and they'll do it during the lame duck, and it will just expire.
Yeah.
How would you react to that?
I don't know. In some ways, Mike, I stare at the deal, and the effective benefits that the Iranians get from the deal they are largely getting today. If you ask why they haven't accepted our concessions so far, which have been staggering and enormous and confounding, and in spite of what senior leaders in the White House and State Department have said, there is nothing longer, there is nothing stronger, there is nothing better about this revised version of the deal as I understand it. And the administration has made no claim that they're frankly doing what they promised they would do. Remember, Secretary Kerry said originally, no enrichment. I mean, this is how far the world has moved multiple times. No enrichment, no enrichment. Now the question is, do you let them enrich, you know, enough for 6 bombs or 50 bombs?
Yeah.
And I think the Iranians are getting most of what they need. They're in no hurry. The administration may need this so they can check the box and claim they've vindicated President Obama's his signature second term initiative, right? This has become the deal itself has become an article of faith for the administration because it's the same cast of characters, right? It's Wendy Sherman, it's O'Malley, it's Sullivan, it's the same people who did this the first time feel like that our withdrawal from that was, you know, I won't use a word my mother wouldn't be proud of. Improper.
Yeah.
And so they are trying to vindicate that. And so there's some of that. Because in effect, they've given the Iranians the vast majority of what it is they need. And within, by 2026 or 7, even if signed, the vast majority of the restrictions will be off and the Iranians will be able to spend centrifuges. And anybody who doesn't think that there will be another 3 or 4 Arab countries that begin to spin their own centrifuges, I think fundamentally misunderstands risk analysis in the Middle East.
It's really remarkable. One of the things that is remarkable about it. So you're saying basically the Iranians get the best of both worlds this way.
Today they have that,
and they also have us on our knees begging them. Which, in the Middle East, people are so sensitive to the power dynamics. You know, who goes? Every politician is really. You know who. Who goes to whose office, right?
Right?
Who's requesting? Who's giving? Right? So they have Rob Malley sitting in Vienna, and the Iranians refuse to meet with him, and yet he still goes. Right? They use this in the Middle East to say, look at the Americans. We debase ourselves in this way.
Yeah.
It's shocking to me.
Isn't it remarkable too? So they've done this. The Iranians refuse to meet with O'Malley. At the same time, Arab leaders are refusing to talk to the United States as well. So the theory is, well, you have to pick a side. They picked a side, but it turns out nobody likes what they're doing. Weakness is abhorred.
Yeah.
And in the Middle East, never respected. And I think what they can all see is that we have become a much less relevant participant. And you could argue there are those, even in my party, who argue that's a good thing. I would tell you for American national security, it is deeply dangerous to walk away from this place that we have been dragged into time and time again. And the malign actor there is pretty clear. And people say, well, the country X is bad, country Y is bad. We suffered when the murder of Khashoggi took place, right? Oh, how can you still have a relationship, a partnership with the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia? I always ask this question. When it all goes to hell, who's going to be firing at your guys and who's going to be firing at their guys? Right. And I can assure you that there is one nation in the Middle East that will be firing at our guys and a whole bunch that will be firing at their guys. And that's how we ought to, this is how Kansans think about the world, right? Like you've got a property line where your farm is and that's the barbed wire fence and you know, like who's, right? It is not that complicated. And
right.
It turns out this administration's now got everybody thinking, I wonder if I wanna be America's partner. So if I wanna hedge my bets in material ways by sucking up to the Chinese or the Russians or somebody else because America refuses to do the basic blocking and tackling.
Yeah, the Chinese are going to move in. That's they're already moving into that space. They're selling ballistic missiles, drones, co-producing them. The UAE was building allowing the Chinese to build a military facility there.
The Emiratis have reestablished a diplomatic relationship with the Iranians.
And the Kuwaitis. Right.
This is rational hedging behavior.
Yeah, it's totally rational.
Yeah.
Well, I have other questions here for you, but I think we probably also have people in the audience who want to. Let me just ask you one more. It's so obvious. You know, John Walters, our leader here at Hudson, he told me that he'd like to see me doing more things on the JCPOA, and I said, you know, the problem is it just feels like Groundhog Day. Like we had these arguments, we won them.
Yeah.
Actually, you know, I wanted to emphasize before you said a very important point that maximum pressure was only in place for about 20 months. And so because they argue that maximum pressure didn't work. Right. It was 20 months, and they were fighting against it the whole time. Rob Malley was in New York meeting Zarif, who would actually meet with him right back then. That was when you were in power.
Yeah.
Right. So anyway,
Secretary Kerry was meeting with the Iranian foreign minister during our time in office as well. This is an important point. It is my belief that what he was telling Zarif is just wait. And it turns out he was right.
Yeah. It's the only thing
I'm aware of that Secretary got right. Yeah. Secretary Kerry got right. He told them just wait, and when you wait, you will get relief. And they have received the relief. In spite of the fact that the JCPOA is still not back in effect, they've received the vast majority of the relief.
So here's this will be my last question before we go to the audience here. No, I've lost it again. Where did he go? Yes. Last March, General Stephen Townsend, who led U.S. Africa Command until August, was asked on the record in Congress, would sanctions relief to the Iranians lead to greater terrorism on the part of Iran? Mm-hmm. And God bless the general. He said, resources gained from sanctions relief would increase Iran's illicit shipment of advanced weapons to terror groups operating in Africa and the Near East region. So, I mean, isn't that just obvious?
It is. It's a long-held view. His predecessor, General McKenzie, would have, I don't know that he publicly said it, but he would likely have lived the same thing. These soldiers, our military, is living that. Right, they are living. We still have a presence in Syria where the Iranians are active. We have significant presence in along the Persian Gulf and Al Udeid and in Bahrain where the Fifth Fleet is headquarters. They are living the risk, and they can see the material impact of constraining the Iranian forces. When we don't reestablish deterrence, they can see it's their guys, their gals that are at risk. So it doesn't surprise me that General Townsend said that he both thought it and wanted to put it out on the record.
I'm glad he did, because one of the talking points of the administration, whenever they're asked by the press, isn't this going to make terrorism worse? They say, everything gets worse if Iran has a nuclear bomb. But that's actually not true.
It's actually, fundamentally, it's actually the inverse of that, and concedes the core point as well, right? It concedes the core point, like, no, it is a certainty that Iran will have the capability of building a nuclear weapons program if we re-enter that agreement. Last thing to say, because this is important, they say, well, we're going to go back and do the second piece of this when it's over. We're going to do this nuclear piece, and then we'll confront the terror problem.
Yeah.
If you think you have no leverage today,
right,
you're completely done. Once sanctions are lifted, it's hopelessly illogical.
It's your point about deterrence.
Yeah.
If you deter them on the terrorism and other conventional activities that they're taking place of, that will deter them on nuclear advancement. If you don't deter them on either, then you're not going to be deterred.
And don't forget, we have great friends and partners helping us on both of these problem sets. Yeah. I traveled to meet the director of Mossad for a reason. There is lots of work that has been done. It is not impossible to do. We did it pretty damn consistently for 4 years. and you can continue to chip away and make it much less likely that the next guy decides, you know, I think I want to grow up and be an Iranian nuclear scientist.
Before one more question before we go to the audience here. I don't get to spend that much time with this. Because we're talking about deterrence here, and let me just take you off Iran for a second to Russia, because we just had a nuclear threat from Vladimir Putin. And if you were advising the president, it's a pretty chilling threat. How would you advise responding against that?
So it's a difficult question. It's a difficult question because I don't know that a public response from this administration is going to amount to a hill of beans. Mm. We talk about language. What should one say? When the most important thing we all have to consider is what will one do, and what has demonstrably one shown that they are prepared to do. And so I think if the administration came out and said, we're going to do X and Y and Z, query whether it would be credible or not. And so you have to be very careful about what you say publicly if it's not going to be viewed credibly, because you can in fact make it worse. So I suspect if I was sitting there today, given the first 18, 19, 20 months of this administration, and I were making a recommendation to this president, I think I would recommend that my response to them be private and credible, and give them half a dozen things that we intend to do, and then actually move pieces around the world, and we're actually working on this. Show them the memo, show them the order, right? Not words, but actual deeds that demonstrate that this is an unacceptable activity, and that the cost will be high, and that we have friends and partners that are prepared to engage in that alongside of us. But I think I would suggest, given where we are today, that conversation ought to be much more direct, much more supported by action, and likely not done in the public sphere.
Okay.
There's three thoughts given. You asked me if I was advising him today, this president today, that's what I would.
Let's talk that's more
what,
action.
That's what I would recommend.
Okay.
And this president probably tell me, no, I'm not going to do that.
So who has a question? Walter Russell Mead.
Yes, sir. Good to see you. I saw you laughing when he said one more question for the third time.
Well, yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
I've spent enough time with Mike Duran over the years to know how the show works. So if I remember that Senator Cotton warned the Iranians that any JCPOA would have no impact beyond the Obama administration if Republicans took power.
Yeah.
Given that we may see Republican control of Congress after November, given that the 2024 election looks the way it does, what do you think are the options that would exist to sort of, in a sense, render void a JCPOA, even if it's signed by the president in Vienna? How much value should the Iranians attach to that signature?
Walter, the two different questions. I'll answer the second one. They should attach 16, 17 months worth of value to it, but that'll be significant because Katie barred the door. These things are hard to get back in place. You described us having the sanctions in place for just 20 months out of our 48. This is not instantaneous. You don't get from where we were when we came into office to where we were 26, 27 months into office. It just takes time. The machine takes time. You have to do the work to be prepared to pull ships, right? You have to actually be, to enforce sanctions is a physical action. There's just tons of work that goes into no BS enforcement. And I also was reminded, and we haven't talked about this, doing this in the face of enormous European opposition, who want to blow through these sanctions and threaten to try and go around SWIFT for my entire time, and they never did. Not a dollar did they get around SWIFT. And everybody said they could. Everybody said American sanctions alone won't work. You should ask the central bankers in Iran if the American sanctions were effective by the time we left office. So they'll have a short time period, but it will be significant, and there will be a lag effect for whoever. If it's a Republican who's elected and they move down a path that looked like what we were doing, It will take them some time to get that back in place. And it's probably also harder the second time to do, because we got a lot of cooperation, because it was just brutal, because we were very clear about our expectations. That's hard to do the second time, because every country, including the Middle Eastern countries, are going to say, here we go again, cycle seven. And so it does become harder. Second, your first question was, what could be done? What would be the immediate aftermath if we take control of Congress? There's not a ton that Congress can do, assuming you don't get 61 Republican senators that can actually put something on the president's desk and put political pressure on. But you should never forget there are, and the Iranians should never forget, there are 10 or 15 Democrat senators who, they wouldn't use the language that I used today, but would view the risk of reentering this deal much like I evaluate that risk as well. So the Iranians should not underestimate that if we end up with 51 Republicans, and so a Senate majority leader who can control the docket, and a majority leader, a Speaker of the House in the House of Representatives, that there could well be legislation that gets to the president's desk that puts him in the very same place that's causing them not to reenter the JCPOA for the election, to make a politically difficult decision. And so so I'm hopeful that we will go get to test that theory. Anyway, does that answer your question, at least in part? It's hard for the legislature, it's for this foreign policy, and these sanctions are executive branch driven under our Constitution. So it is difficult, but there are certainly things that can be done to force the president to do more. Just as with President Obama, who claimed all these, you remember, President Obama goes out and claims, I put the toughest sanctions ever on Iran, which was actually true at the time. We surpassed that. But this was getting in front of the parade after it was already headed down the street. He opposed them. He fought them. Once he saw that he didn't have the votes and it was coming to him, he flipped and said, I signed them and did this great thing. You could do that to a President Biden in his last 2 years. I guess I shouldn't say that. In what I hope will be his last 2 years.
Chris DeMuth here, and then Todd Lindbergh.
Chris, how are you, sir?
The Trump administration was a 4 years of historic progress in the Middle East. And it looks as if the current 4 years are going to be years of historic deterioration. I'm wondering whether, if a new administration took office in January of 2025, that was inclined to continue what the Trump administration had done. But so much history had been written, things had changed. Yeah. You've discussed how much things will deteriorate. And imagine this is a time when our resources in Europe, in Eastern Europe, in the Pacific are strained. The budget situation has deteriorated terribly. We could be in a recession. I don't think we just simply say, well, we're going to go back to the Abraham Accords and, yeah, you know, we're going to put pressure on Iran. It's going to require a lot of imagination and something new and different. And I'm just trying, yeah, to imagine, after the 4 years that we're in right now, what would it take to restore some kind of sensible policies in the Middle East?
Yeah. Now, Chris, you make a really good point, and I know you've written about this too. This budget issue is very real, where we will sit in terms of capital investment. We're having a huge recruiting problem. I mean, so we have a workforce issue and a capital investment issue taking place in our national security environment today. So I agree, whoever's sitting in the Oval Office in January 25 will face a fundamentally different landscape than we did in January of 2017. I concede that. It means you have to be a little more creative and build. I think the theory of the case remains right. I think as you stare at the tool set to accomplish the twin missions, right, of pushing back against Iranian malfeasance and their nuclear program, I think the central theme line of deny them resources is critical. So I think you continue that mission. But your point is very well taken. I've spoken about this a lot. We have a gap in the Navy that is real and serious. While we're trying to go build out a capability in a place that is an awful long ways away in the Pacific. January 25 may not be quite the low point, but it will. You will be able to see it from there. And the next president will be able to see that gap, and Xi Jinping can see that gap, importantly, as well. So I agree, there will be increased creativity. It's hard to know the trajectory for, I guess we're now 30 months from that, something like that, just a little less than 30 months from that. We know the trajectory, we don't know the slope and the rate of decay. What I would also hope is that some of our friends and partners would see the American rate of decay and do something that is, I will concede, ahistoric. They will begin to try and lead us back in the right path. And I've watched what Japan is doing, good on them. I hope the Australians and the South Koreans will begin to push us instead of us as a historic matter pushing them. And I describe all this as to, so that the rate of decay over the next 30 months is lower. So the next president who comes in has a foothold to begin to build out both the work that needs to be done in Asia and the important work in Southwest Asia as well, in the Middle East.
Could you give it to Todd there?
Yeah. Thanks, Mike. I loved your last question. It sometimes takes you a while to get to your best question, but it was an excellent question. Thank you. And I thought the answer was quite interesting, too. I reflected back on some things you said here previously, which is about the role of warning in mm-hmm. diplomacy. You've said that on more than one occasion when you were secretary, you issued rather sharp warnings to foreign governments about the possible consequences for their actions. And I know, obviously, there's a lot of that is beyond the realm of discussion in public. Mm-hmm. But I wondered if you could talk a little bit more about that in general. And, of course, Mike's question was, what would you say to this administration? He previously described this administration as one that was projecting an aura of weakness and that therefore a public statement might not be quite as appropriate. And another administration might actually not project an aura of weakness under circumstances such as these, and therefore the advice, the counsel you might give might be different.
Yeah.
So I would just ask you if you'd be willing to explore those,
the
history and the hypotheticals a little bit.
So it's hard to answer in the generic. Simple deterrence theory, right? So that comes back to game theory. I was an operations research engineering guy, right? So but you just go back to simple game theory. More players there are, the more complicated it gets. And the less clarity there is around the rules, the less certainty has about outcomes. And the rules have two components to them. How are the rules drafted? And second, is anybody going to enforce them? Right? So there are three pieces to this. And as one thought about, and we contemplated this many times, of what should we say? What should I say? What should the Secretary of Defense or the Chairman of Joint Chiefs of Staff say to our friends and allies? How ought we to phrase it? What format ought we to present it? And what are the things we're prepared to do to demonstrate that now we're actually going to go deliver against either a promise we were making or a threat that we were putting before them? And so there were things we didn't get right, too. No one should leave here today thinking we got it right all the time. That is fundamentally untrue. But boy, we were pretty thoughtful about how we did this. And I think it accrued cumulatively to our benefit, right? So it's not even just in the instance. It is the cumulative set of commitments that one makes and what percentage of them you actually live up to, because nobody gets to all of them. But we made fewer promises and lived up to a greater percentage of them. And I think over time, our friends and adversaries came to see that. Like, oh, they may not do exactly what it is we wanted, but boy, if they tell us they're going to do it, they are likely to be able to not only effort to live up to it, but actually execute against it. Because those are two different pieces of it as well. Your second question was sort of coming back to this challenge that Putin presents today, where he is talking about using nuclear weapons. I think it's important. It gets thrown around a little bit lazily in the media. So the nuclear weapons that he'll use aren't the ICBMs that Ronald Reagan went to Reykjavik to deal with, right? This is a different kettle of fish. It presents a different problem. And so when folks say, well, we respond in kind with nuclear weapons, this is public information, the American strategic response is not to respond in kind. We reserve the right to do so. But if it's an artillery piece that fires a tactical nuclear weapon, there are many tools that one can take out their capacity to deliver a tactical nuclear weapon that don't involve countering with a nuclear weapon oneself. And then there are many other tools that one can use, many of which I can't speak about today, but we have many other options for how one to respond. And so this is to your question. These are the things that we should be putting in place, that if you're trying to deliver deterrence against Vladimir Putin's assertion that he is prepared to use tactical nuclear weapons, there are many physical manifestations of a credible deterrent response that you could provide and show to Vladimir Putin and military leadership around him that says that this will end badly. And those are the important things. Happy to bluster at the UN. Sign me up. But in the end, nobody gives a damn. Certainly Vladimir Putin doesn't care. What he cares about is, oh my goodness, they actually did X or Y or Z. Or better still, X and Y and Z. Those are the kinds of things one can do to begin to your point, to message and communicate both with our Ukrainian friends, our European friends and partners, expectations for what it is that they're going to need to do in the event of, and how it is that the United States will respond. And last thing to say here, you can kill all of this capacity to communicate and deter with process. If the answer to a Russian tactical nuclear weapon is that you call a meeting of the National Security Council, the deputies gathered is death. Okay? And I love deputies. They're important. They do amazing work in preparation and planning. And the assistant, this is all incredibly valuable. You need to have done that work. You need to have built your understanding based on all the work that everyone does at every level, at DOD, at State, at the NSC, at DHA, all the places that have a touch point on this. But in the moment, when you hear somebody says, yes, the assistant deputies are gathering at the White House for an NSC meeting, here's what Vladimir Putin knows. That's fascinating. Great meeting. Hope they publish the notes. In the moment, it is for execution. And there's only one person that gives the execution order, and I'm happy to gather the senior leaders and everybody look at each other in the eye one more time and make sure that they've got it right. I'm not suggesting chaos and rogueness. But when you begin to attach process to your response in the moment, you've lost it.
Peter Rao. And Peter, I think you're going to give us the last question. And it should be a two-parter because you should ask also about the protests going on in Iran today.
Well, this is...
That's as good as it gets.
This has been great. This reminds me of my... My favorite sports talk show from years ago, Mike and Mike in the Mornings. It's not yet noon, so...
All right, you got to tell me which one of those mics you think I am.
I guess I will ask about the protests then. Maybe you could comment on those. But I also wanted, as part of my two-parter, maybe ask a broader question. Some of our friends in the foreign policy world are increasingly pitching the idea that the U.S. should focus on defending the beaches of Taiwan, and that's essentially it. I think as Governor Palin put it years ago about the Middle East, let Allah sort it out. In Europe, there's plenty of wealthy democracies that should be able to check Russia, is the thinking. You obviously stand for a muscular, engaged America, at least that's kind of the tenor of your remarks, and I think that's in part what Hudson stands for. So maybe could you offer your views on this, your take on that?
I'll take that one first, and I'll go to the protest. We can finish up there. Let me take it in the reverse. Let me do the protest first because the other one's a broader question about America's place in the world. And so perhaps that's a better place to close. Look, the protests are great. We whenever the protests occurred in our watch, we tried to support them, provide them things that we could provide them, assistance, help, certainly our prayers and moral support as well, in addition to anything else we could do on the ground. There are protests in Iran all the time. The Basij, the internal Iranian security forces, I think have this all in hand. And I am very confident that orders given from from New York City will make clear, don't give them an inch. And they're not likely to give them an inch. They'll let them protest a little bit, but they'll do what they did to that young lady. They'll kill whoever they need to kill in order to retain their capacity and their power. There'll come a day when that statement's wrong. And we don't know when that day is. Just as I always recall, I left Germany as a young lieutenant patrolling the East German border in October of 89, and in a couple of weeks, the fence line I was patrolling for 3 years was gone. No one knew the day, but it happened. It was inevitable because of the work that so many before me had done. And it is inevitable that someday the Iranian people will get back a government that they deserve. What's happening there is tragic. It's another example of why it's just nutty to be sitting at the table with these folks. It's not that human rights is the end all. We don't. We make decisions for America. But to think for a moment that this regime is going to deliver on any of the promises they make is just, it doesn't reflect the history of these very leaders, these same people. And as the transition is made, and the Ayatollah passes and a new Ayatollah is selected, you can bet that it won't get any better for the Iranian people. I couldn't tell you who it's going to be. Seen lots of intelligence predictions. By the way, the Ayatollah's death was predicted like 47 times when I was CIA director. so I just call me skeptical. But someday we all go. The good Lord takes us all. And when that day comes, I think it's unlikely to change in any material way the Iranian outlook. I hope that the Iranian people get that moment and get that space, and maybe they can break it free. But if they have more money, if the regime has more money, that's another reason the JCPOA is a bad idea. If the regime has more money, that's less likely to happen. You were talking about Taiwan and Taiwan's defense. So I have made clear I didn't do this when I was a secretary. I've done this as a civilian. I think we should recognize Taiwanese sovereignty. It's an independent nation. I joke that I traveled there. I'm actually traveling there again next week. I'm banned from going to China, so must not be. my passport's going to clear customs. Counting on it. We should acknowledge that. I think that's important. I couldn't tell you what the administration's policy is on Taiwan today. I don't mean that lightly. I think that's dangerous. So our ambiguity today is ambiguous because they just can't get a clear message. Even the president yesterday from the UN, I couldn't tell you. He did make clear statements that we would defend Taiwan. Good on him. I hope his team is on board with that. And I hope, more importantly, that they actually have the planning in place to execute it, not so that we can do it and do it effectively, but because to the extent we've demonstrably done that, then it's less likely to happen. And so in the end, this is about getting your friends and partners prepared to deliver a deterrence message that is truly credible. And I don't think we have that. And I think this next 3 to 5 years is really risky. And it is enormously important for any American who thinks, why do I care about Taiwan? Just pull your phone out of your pocket and grab a semiconductor that was almost certainly manufactured in some material respects in that place. When you get in your car, when you open your refrigerator, when you drive your motorcycle, when you run your tractor on a Kansas farm, you are almost certainly going to be using a semiconductor that comes from Taiwan. Xi Jinping knows this too. It would be, if you think the economy is struggling today, shut down TSMC for about a week, and we will all be struggling to figure out how to turn the lights on across the world. This matters. We have to get this right. Our partners and friends in the region have to get this right. And the administration needs to make unambiguous to Xi Jinping that an attack, and I use that term broadly, this doesn't just mean planes and ships, an attack on the sovereignty of Taiwan will be met with a response that will have a greater cost to the Chinese people than it will to the American people. That, in the end, is the calculus for Xi Jinping, and it is his perception of that risk that will drive success. Anyway, good. So, okay. Mike, thank you. Thank you all. Thanks for your time today.
Thanks very much. Really appreciate it.